I often make videos about engines, and of course, in these videos, I often say the words internal combustion engine repeatedly. And from time to time, people ask me, why do you keep saying internal combustion engine? It's not like we have external combustion engines. Well, that's exactly what I have here before me right now. And as you can see, it's an external combustion engine. There is no combustion going on inside it, in the cylinder, or anywhere else. The only form of combustion is this candle-like flame on the outside of the engine, hence the name external combustion engine. And as you can see, wait a bit, takes a bit of time to heat up. And there you go. And as you can see, it works and runs, and it produces actual power. External combustion engines like this one have a name, and they're called hot air or Stirling engines. Now, the amazing thing about Stirling engines is that unlike conventional internal combustion engines, they don't need any sort of additional mechanical devices to make them operate. So they don't need stuff like carburetors or injectors, cams, valves, spark plugs, throttle bodies, timing chains, belts, you name it. They don't need any of that. Also, they don't need a cooling circuit with a cooling liquid to keep the temperatures down. And as you can see, they don't even need to be lubricated while they're running. They're dead simple. So the question we have to ask then is, if they don't need any of these things, how do they work? Our engine consists of two cylinders and two pistons. The cylinders are interconnected and the air can pass from one to the other. This cylinder and piston are adjacent to our heat source, but the piston inside the cylinder is a loose fit. The other cylinder is away from the heat source, but the piston inside it is tight fitting. Now, only one of these pistons actually does the work to generate power. The other one is just a helper. Do you know which is which? To answer that question, we have to follow the path of the air inside the engine, while remembering that air density changes with temperature. The hotter the air, the less dense it is. The less dense it is, the more it expands and the more pressure it exerts on its surroundings. So air is heated here at the heat source. As it's heated, it expands, but because our piston in this cylinder is a loose fitting, the air simply passes around it and moves through the passage between our two cylinders where it meets with our tight fitting piston. Because this piston is tight fitting, the air cannot go around it, and because it has nowhere else to go, it exerts its pressure on the tight fitting piston, pushing it outward. This rotates the flywheel and generates power. As you can see, our engine also has cooling fins on it. Now, cooling fins dramatically increase surface area, making it possible to release more heat into the surrounding air, which means that once air reaches this space, it starts to cool down. As it cools down, the air becomes less dense and air pressure now drops. But we still have ample momentum left in the flywheel, so the tight-fitting piston starts coming around, and now it pushes the cooled, depressurized air past our loose-fitting piston, back to the hot side of the engine, where the air again heats up, expands, and the cycle repeats itself. But this then begs the question, what does our loose-fitting piston that's right in here actually do if the air just goes around it all the time? Is it completely useless? No, it's not. This piston is called a displacer piston, and as the name suggests, it displaces air. In other words, it occupies the space where you don't want a significant quantity of air at any particular time. As you can see, the two pistons are offset 90 degrees from each other. This means that our displacer piston is always a quarter of a rotation ahead of our working tight-fitting piston, meaning that when the working piston nears its topmost position and gets ready to receive the pressure of the expanding air, the displacer piston will occupy the lower, cooler part of the heated cylinder to ensure that most of the air goes nearest the heat source so that it can receive as much of the heat as possible. As the working piston travels through the bottom of its stroke and gets ready to push the cool air back to the hot side, the displacer piston occupies the hottest part of the engine so that most of the air can get as cool as possible. And that's the simple beauty of Stirling engines. They basically function on the potential energy that exists in the temperature difference of air. They never have to ingest new air and expel burnt air and fuel like conventional engines need to do all the time. Instead, these engines keep the same air forever sealed inside the engine. They simply heat and cool that air. As a result, the air expands and contracts. This moves the pistons and creates work and power. And it also creates other very interesting benefits, because we're never igniting an air-fuel mixture and creating powerful, rapid, loud combustions. These engines are much quieter than conventional engines. But they're not just quieter, they're also cleaner. Because if you were to lock yourself in a room with this one, you'd be dead in, I don't know, an hour? Maybe two? I have no idea. Never tried. Don't intend to. You could lock yourself with this one in a room for, I don't know, maybe days, maybe even longer. Because the only thing that's creating work here is the open flame, our heat source. And as you know, basically sitting with a candle in a room didn't really kill anybody, unless the candle falls down and burns the curtains, but yeah. It also gives you the choice of using very clean, environmentally friendly fuels for your heat source, because all you need is heat, any kind of heat. You're not picky with your heat, you just need to create a temperature difference. And it also means that you don't really need to create heat specifically for the engine to run. You can use waste heat, heat that is used for nothing, which means that these engines can be completely emissions free. In fact, they can be emissions negative because they're using wasted heat. For example, imagine a gas boiler. It's creating heat. If you combine it with a Stirling engine, you can create electricity from that waste heat. And that's exactly what some companies from the UK and New Zealand have been doing and experimenting with on the market. So they are quieter, they are cleaner, and they're also obviously much more simple, which means they're more cost effective and they have far less maintenance. So why aren't they as widespread as internal combustion engines, conventional ones? Are they perhaps not as powerful? Well, to an extent, yes. This does not have as good of a power to weight ratio as this. And that's because obviously there's a lot less potential energy in the changing temperature of air than it is in the ignition and rapid combustion of a properly measured mixture of air and fuel. However, this doesn't mean that Stirling engines are weak, and they also have the option of conventional engines of increasing the size and number of cylinders to make more power.
have no idea how well you can hear me because this one is kind of loud, even if you lift it off from the table. Okay, not that loud when you lift it off. But when it's on the table, it's making the whole table vibrate. Let me just calm that down. And as you can see, it's coloring a very bright changing color LED, so that is some serious power from four candles. Now, let me extinguish them. Watch, it's still running, watch. It's not even slowing down. Look. Still running. Still running, still running, still producing electricity. This is just the heat that remains, okay? We're not consuming any energy right now. We're not adding any new heat. And this is how they can be so environmentally friendly and efficient. Whenever there's a burst of waste heat, even thermal power plants, for example, they make massive amounts of waste heat. These things can make use of that. Okay, that was, I don't know, a little less than a minute of running on basically nothing.
Now, this is a hobby-grade engine, but as you have seen, it ran for quite some time on nothing but waste heat. Basically, the remaining temperature difference between this part and this part. We were not adding any new energy into the system. We were not consuming any fuel for a short period of time, but we were creating enough power to power this little LED bulb. We were creating electricity on waste heat. And this then gets you thinking, where is there waste heat? Well, there is waste heat everywhere. Humans are producing incredible amounts of it everywhere. You turn off your cooking hob or your oven and there's waste heat in there, enough of it to power a little stirring for maybe a minute or two or three and make some electricity. You turn off your car and you park it, there's enough waste heat in the exhaust manifold to power a little stirring for, I don't know, 5, 10, 15, maybe even 20 minutes and charge the batteries of a hybrid vehicle while the vehicle is stationary, parked, not being used. The batteries are charged, but the vehicle isn't plugged into anything. Thermal power plants, massive, incredible amounts of waste heat that could power, I don't know, hundreds of Stirlings or a giant Stirling or whatever. Burning garbage, the list goes on. There's waste heat everywhere. But of course, implementing these solutions that harness this energy using Stirling engines everywhere requires mechanical complexity, cost, and space. However, I think that our willingness to implement creative energy solutions will be greater as energy efficiency becomes more and more important in the future. So there's potential for this thing to save the world, but I didn't answer the original question, and it is, why isn't this as widespread as the conventional internal combustion engine if this is so great? Well, there's two reasons. Reason number one is, as you have seen, this is not that easy to start. An internal combustion engine starts instantly. You turn the key, you press a button, boom, comes to life. This, no. It takes some time for it to heat up so that you can start it. You have to build a temperature difference. And due to the same reason, we have horrible power modulation in Stirling engines, which makes them much more suitable to stationary applications. NASA did try something in the, I think, 80s, and they made cars powered with that, but ultimately the conclusion is that due to power modulation, they're not really that suited, because a conventional engine has a throttle body or something similar, and you can nearly instantly modulate the power. With a small power output, big power output, you just press a pedal. This, no. And that's because the temperature of materials cannot change instantly. They heat up and cool down gradually. So power modulation, absolutely horrible, which is why we're likely not going to be seeing them powering vehicles anytime soon. However, they are powering vehicles, and they're doing it in a way that a conventional internal combustion engine never could. And that's because they're really quiet. This is Sweden's Gotland-class submarine, considered by many to be the hardest to detect, quietest submarine ever. Why? Because its underwater propulsion system is based around two Stirling engines. Liquid oxygen and diesel is stored in tanks in the submarine, and it creates heat for the Stirling engines, and then the Stirling engines either drive the propellers directly or run generators that charge batteries, making the submarine really, really quiet. It's quieter than anything with an internal combustion engine, but it's also quieter than a nuclear submarine because, yes, the nuclear reactor doesn't create noise itself. However, what creates noise in a nuclear submarine is big pumps and big motors running these pumps that pump giant amounts of cooling water into the nuclear reactor to keep it cool. So this is behind the quietest sub ever. So yeah, that's pretty much it for today. Stirling engines, I really like them because they teach us how there's potential for energy pretty much everywhere, and even in places where you think that there isn't any. But these, they harness it and they make work from what seems to be nothing. So yeah, as always, thanks a lot for watching, and I'll be seeing you soon with more fun and useful stuff on the D4A channel.